Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our ESI webinar. So today we'll be talking about taking into account stamping and welding to improve the distortion and crash performance predictions. This will be presented to you by Arthur Camano, so our Business Development Director for Virtual Manufacturing. If you have any questions, please use your chatter box and we will have a short Q&A questions at the end of the presentation. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I will just start quickly with a brief introduction of myself. So I am a mechanical engineer with 20 years, roughly 20 years of experience in manufacturing simulation. I used to work quite a lot with stamping, casting, welding, and composites. That's a part of ESI that deals with manufacturing simulation. My main area of expertise is stamping simulation. That's where I spent most of my time with. I was responsible for opening ESI Group's subsidiary in Brazil. That I'm from Brazil, and I opened the office of ESI in Brazil in 2000. And I developed the market of Brazil's from 2000 to 2016. I building the office, growing the office, growing the market. Last year, I moved from Brazil to Michigan, and now I am the director of virtual manufacturing business development. And this is my first winter here, so getting used to it. So let's start talking about coupling of stamping and welding simulations. I like to divide this subject into three main areas. First one for structural parts. What's the benefit of doing this coupling for structural parts? You can study here clamping and welding sequencing. You can study global distortions. And you can know the final thickness distribution of your assembly, right? These are, I think, the bigger benefits of studying, of coupling, stamping, and welding for structural parts. For doors and closures, here we can normally study assembly sequencing, hemming strategy. You can understand what's the best way to hem your parts, taking into account the stamping springback. You can look, of course, about global distortions. That's the end of your hemming. You can look at the final shape. You can study gaps and flushes in a much more accurate way, because you have then a very accurate final shape of your assembly. So you can know very, in a much better way, what are the gaps and flushes between panels, and surface defects, right? Because after hemming or after assembly, you have an influence on surface defects. Sometimes your outer skin, it looks okay, and then after hemming, it doesn't look okay, or maybe vice versa. So you can do that, you can study that. And for crash and safety, by bringing the stamp history and mainly the hardening, you have a much better correlation, right? Also, the assembly history, when you assemble parts, you pre-stress your assemblies, and this can have an effect on your crash behavior. So I'm going to talk a little more about these three different areas. Starting with structural parts. So again, we're going to look at clamping and welding sequencing, global distortions, and this results in a final thickness distribution. So if I take as an example a B pillar, this is a B pillar. This is an actual B pillar from an OEM with three parts. So the outer B pillar, number one, and two inner B pillars, two and three. Normally, what we do here, we do stamping Then we position it, we clamp it, and then we weld it, right? So if we talk about first about stamping and positioning, so the stamping itself, it's very standard. There is nothing different in this stamping simulation than the regular or the usual stamping simulations you do, right? This, you just take your stamping from your stamping software, in this case PAM stamp, and you get those three results after trimming. So you stamp, you trim, and you have a spring back, right? Then after that, you can position the parts against each other, and you can see it. It's a very, very delicate movement, but you can see parts moving against each other. So you need to position them first, then to clamp it. And just by doing positioning, here you see some displacement. Of course, you are moving parts against each other, and there is already some stress build up because of the positioning, right? Because you have these positioning devices, and sometimes because the parts are not matching each other, you kind of force them to place, and this builds up some stress. After positioning, we do clamping. So you can see here the clamping sequencing on both sides. So you clamp in a defined sequence. This sequence can be changed. Sometimes clamping parts in a different sequence can improve results. You can have less displacement. And again, this will introduce more stress. More stresses to the structure, right? Finally, we spot weld. So you have the parts are together, they are well located, and then you spot weld them. You see here there is a defined sequence, which is you go in the lower side first, all the way, and then you go back. And this will give us a shape. Right, and sometimes by changing this sequencing, you can improve the shape, the final shape of your assembly. You go from the center to the edges, or if you do both sides at the same time, there are many different ways to do it. Right. So finally, what you want to look at is the displacement of your assembly. Now, how your final assembly looks like. You can look at these results directly in the interface. So you look at the B pillar alone, or if you want, you can compare the results of your simulation with the parts, the geometries from CAD, right? And this is an animation that will show you. You have the CAD geometry in gray, and you have the simulated geometry in red, and then you can do whatever you want. You can do sections, you can do cut planes, and then you can understand exactly where the discrepancies are and where you really need to fix one part against each other, right? So then the next question here is, okay, I see I do an assembly, I do it in an accurate way, I clamp it, I weld it, but I still see distortions. I mean, I still see a shape which is not the one I'm looking for. So for that, you can do, how can you fix that? You can do, for instance, weld sequence optimization, and we have in our software we have a functionality that is doing that. So you do the setup of this model. Let's say this is a this is actually a real model from another OEM. And then you have the approach. You have this 1, 2, 3. It's a step-by-step approach to set up the model. And then finally, you define the sequence of your welding points. It can be a spot weld, it can be seam weld. And then you see here, it's just like a table where you see each of these entries are the spot welds. And then at the end, you see the clamping tools. So here it's a simple approach. You do one weld after the other. That's the first idea, the first try we made with this case. And then we run a simulation, and this simulation runs quickly. It's like a few minutes. And then you look at results. Then you can go to this step 5, which is the weld sequence optimization. Then there are some questions like, what do you want to optimize? Do you want to optimize distortions in Z directions, for instance? Do you want to optimize, the X direction, for instance, or what's more important for you? Then it runs several different tries and always trying to minimize distortions. And in this case specifically, compared to the very first try, we had a 15% improvement. And compared to the worst case, we had a 25% improvement on distortions. So that's one of the ways to try to fix distortions. Note that we are not here touching surfaces, right? We're not changing shapes. We are just trying to change the sequencing, and by doing that, we're improving the results. And the second approach is by doing this changing shapes, right? Like if you have this this structure, and you know that after simulation, you see that the structure is moving, the center is moving down by, for instance, 7 millimeters. You can do a pre-bending, and that's exactly what is shown here. You do a pre-bending of the structure, and then you weld it. And then after, in this specific case, after welding, it went up by 6 millimeters. So this structure at the end, it was 1 millimeter off, and not 7 millimeters off. Right. With the same idea, you can morph, you can change the shape of your initial parts. Right. That's to do that, you need to bring from your stamping a shape which is not anymore the design shape. So you have to assume that the shape you're bringing from stamping is off. Is of the desired isolated part shape, right? If you have a B pillar, you are bringing a B pillar which is from stamping, a B pillar outer which is not exactly matching the CAD. And then you know that after welding, then it will go to the desired shape. Some OEMs are doing that already, right? So this is it for the underbody parts. Regarding doors and closures, it's a slightly different approach, and that's why I like to separate the presentation. Here we can look at assembly sequencing, hemming strategy, global distortions, again gaps and flushes, surface defects. Okay, it doesn't make sense to look at gaps, flushes, surface defects on underbody parts, but here it makes a lot of sense. So what's the motivation of doing all that simulation? We know that today the number one customer perception of quality of a product, customers are normally looking at a car and they are looking at gaps between panels and flushness between panels. And even people who don't understand very much about mechanics and how a car is made of and things like that, they have the perception of the quality of the car by looking at these gaps and flushes. So OEMs are paying a lot of attention and trying to deliver products or panels that are very, very close to each other and looking very nicely, because that's probably a very important point for someone who's buying a car these days. So the usual practice, how normally companies are working today, the assembly process is not simulated. So you have different engineers working with different parts. So you have one engineer working on the outer deck lid, another engineer who is responsible for the reinforcements, another engineer, this is the outer deck lid. And then when all these results are put together on the shop floor, they really don't match the expected shape. And then, of course, a lot of time and money is spent to rework the hardware. And you know more than me how much time and effort is needed to fix an assembly, right? The new practice, some OEMs are already working like that, and that's what we are promoting today, is with simulation of assembly to predict distortion. So then you have, again, different engineers working with their parts, but then still in the simulation environment, these different parts are put together and they are checked. If they are okay, fine, then you can move to production, right? If they are not okay, you need to understand how can you fix that assembly, that global shape. Normally, you can fix it by adding reinforcements. You can fix it by morphing panels. Some companies morph inner panels. Some companies morph inner and outer panels. Some companies just add reinforcement as much as they can. So there are different ways to fix an assembly problem. But the point is you fix the problem in the computer. And then when you go to the shop floor, you have a good part, right? So just quickly to show the workflow, how do we work with that? So we simulate single parts as usual. So here you have the inner panel of that deck lid, reinforcement, and the outer panel. So each one will have its own thickness distribution, spring back distribution as usual. And then we're going to take all the forming history of these single parts. We'll go and move to the following assembly operations, right? So here you have the results. So inner panel reinforcement and outer panel. First thing to do is to join inner panel and reinforcements. And this can be done in a very detailed way. You can simulate clamping of reinforcements, welding of reinforcements. And then you're going to add the outer panel. And then normally the outer panel is hemmed with the inner panel plus reinforcements. And then we can simulate also row hemming or tabletop hemming. Or you can mix the two processes. I know some panels are partially hemmed with tabletop and partially hemmed with row hemming. So you can do whatever you want in terms of simulation. You look at the spring back finally, and you normally you want to compare this with your actual CAD parts in car position. So you take into account the where the part is located in your car. You can simulate even a spring back and gravity, so to make sure you have the good position. Then you compare. Then of course you check the distance, and if they don't look okay, you need to go back to designers and find a way to fix it by adding reinforcements, by changing place for of the reinforcements, or there are many ways to, as I just said. Here is just a detail of the welding of the reinforcements. You see here on the right that you clamp them and then you spot weld them, and it's really simulating the spot weld. You see there is a heat affected zone, and there is a sequencing taking into account. So again, you can change this sequence if you want. You can do a study, for instance, of the welding of the reinforcements, just to understand what is the best way to weld the reinforcements. Is it best to weld them at the same time? Is it best to weld them from center to the edges? Or it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You can weld it anyway. So you can do that study as part of your global study. And after this welding, you have a spring back again, because the shape of your inner deck lid will be changed after the reinforcements. Then you put them together and you hem it. This is just a small detail of the hemming result. So you're actually hemming and bending the outer onto the inner panel. You see here the reinforcement. We are taking into account outer and inner panels. We are taking into account that they are all flexible. So even during hemming, your panels are moving and adjusting to each other. And this can if you don't take that into account, you can have a final shape which is not accurate, right? Finally, you have the result. So everything is welded. You put results on top of each other. As I said, you can put all this assembly in car position. You can even apply gravity load, so to make sure that you have this deck lid in a good position in space with a gravity load applied, fixed in the good locations, in the hinges, hinge pockets, and everything. And it's very important to know how to compare results from the simulation with the CAD files, right? That's a big thing. Finally, when you have the your assembly, you can look at the results in our virtual Lightroom. We have inside the software, we have a Lightroom, and these are the reflections of this Lightroom when you bring your simulated panel to be checked to see if you have any problem in the surface as surface defects. Right. Of course, I'm taking into account here all the stamping history, all the assembly, and this can, after assembly, you can maybe see some defects that were not visible before. Okay, this is one of the Lightrooms we have available. You have different Lightrooms you can work with. You can import your own Lightroom if you want. Again, just to give you another example, this is another view of the Lightroom, and this is a hood from CAD. You see the reflections are very nice, they're very smooth. And then when you bring the hood from the CAE, from the simulation, then reflections start to can be affected. So this would mean that you have an issue with surface quality here, of the aspect of your hood of your part. You can do this static images, or you can also do this dynamically. So again, this is a hood from a CAD. You see the reflections, and then the hood from the CAE, when the reflections start to be more realistic and not that perfect, right? You have this environment either in the interface of the software, you can also have an HMD, head-mounted display, and you can look at it in space. So you can have a small HMD installation, which today is an HMD glass is really not anymore expensive, and you can look at these results in space if you want. Regarding crash and safety, so again, we want to bring the stamping history of parts, especially hardening of parts, because hardening will make parts stiffer and the absorption of energy and the way the structure behaves will change because of this stamp history. The assembly history is also important, because very often you're adding a stress, and that pre-stress can also change or can bring you closer to a rupture. Of course, what we want is a much better correlation between crash test, the actual crash test, and the simulated one. So I'll try now to give you an example of that application. Let's say a front hood case. So first thing to do here, if we don't want to get the hood geometry from CAD, we want to stamp it, right? We want to stamp it in the simulation to get all the history and hardening. And the question is always, how can we do a stamping simulation in the very beginning if we don't have tools, right? Normally, when you are at that stage, you don't have tools. You don't have stamping tools. So let's say for the hood inner, we have a software called Die Starter. The Die Starter is really, the objective is to give you a tool design in few minutes. Okay, it's this software is able to design a tool that makes a lot of sense in a few minutes. Maybe it's not exactly the same tool that you will have in production. It's probably not going to be the same for sure, but it's close enough. It's close enough. It gives you a good stamping result that you can work with, right? And you don't need to be a stamping expert. You have very few information the Die Starter is asking you, and then you can have a die, and then you can have a stamping result. So Die Starter can. For designers, it's a very nice tool, because it can quickly tell you if that part is not okay. And Die Starter goes further than a one-step approach, which is normally used. One-step approach of simulation, you're just flattening your parts, so you're not really taking into account the tools. And maybe a part which is not okay in one step, it can be okay when you add the tool, right? So when you have a not okay from Die Starter, then you need to make some change in your part design. So you can do some design iterations, you do a few changes in your part, and you run Die Starter again. And finally, you you have an okay from die starter. Each die starter loop takes a few minutes. And then when you have the okay from die starter, you can do an explicit, an incremental pump stamp simulation, which takes a little bit longer. But because you need residual stresses and thickness history, right? So, and this is how it looks like. But then, since you already have the tool from die starter, you can just very quickly send it to pump stamp and run it. I mean, the connection between these two solutions are very seamless. So this is how we have the stamping history, starting from a part and not having a tool, right? You do die starter and then you get a tool and then you stamp it. Then here you have the inner panel after spring back due to stamping, and then you can assemble it to the outer hood panel. For that, we have this visual assembly software that is positioning things and clamping things together. These are the structures after positioning. And this visual assembly software, it makes it easy for you to position things and place them together. That's really the point of having a software to help you put things together in a quick way. And finally, in this case, you need to hem them together. So again, we can do, in this case, it's a row hemming. So you can row hem them together. So finally, now we have the hood ready to be used for simulation, for crash simulation, but not only for crash simulation. Normally, when you're thinking about a hood, you have many requests or many requirements for the design. Then you have several different simulations that you need to run, and not only the crash. There is the misuse, wind load, static loads, slam, NVH, pedestrian impact. You have to run all these different cases for that hood, right? I'm going to take one of these cases, let's say the slam case. And so if we do a slamming test, normally the target is you don't want to have more plasticity after when you do the slamming. So here, if I take that same hood without any stamping effect, so I'm bringing it directly from CAD, and I do a slamming simulation, I get a not okay. The results are not good. The hook force is too high. If I take that same hood with stamping effects, I see that results are much different, and then the forces are lower and the hood is okay. So by taking into account the stamping effects in that hood, I have the okay in that part. So this means that if I hadn't taken into account the stamping effect, I would have worked on my hood. I would have changed things. I would have changed thicknesses, maybe geometries, and that was really not necessary, because with a stamping effect, what is much closer to reality, then we know that results are good. So that's also the point of having the link. Here, chaining manufacturing with crash, with performance. This is a very simple example, but illustrates very well the difference. On the left, you see this case where we're bringing all the history from stamping and welding, and this has a deformation mode. And on the right, that's more the usual approach that people are bringing things from the CAD, and not taking into account any hardening or anything. So you see that deformation modes are very, very different. Of course, the energy absorption is very different. So that's why we need to take that into account. Here in a more realistic example, if we take this part here, on the left, you have the crash test of the nominal shape coming from CAD. And on the right, you have the crash test of the part that was manufactured and assembled. So very quickly, you see here there is a very different result where the part that was stamped is much harder, and it could stand that crash. So there is no bending here. Even more important is this result here. You see the intrusion was very different. This is the difference you see when you do a frontal crash test with and without stamping history. So there is a big difference in the intrusion. Finally, you have this side crash from a Volkswagen, and this was an actual study that was made. The blue line shows the simulation of as designed, so parts coming from CAD, and you see the contact forces and deformation, right? And then you have the actual crash test results in gray, and then in red you have the crash test simulation if you bring the manufacturing history. You see, of course, it shows that we are much closer to reality. More importantly, you see the difference is quite high. It's like 20% difference in terms of force and deformation. So it's quite a lot. So when we bring the stamp history, we normally bring thickness, plastic strain, and residual stress. We can also include the assembly stresses. And it becomes very clear that stamping history is essential for a good correlation. So in conclusion, we have today the capability at ESI to chain stamp assembly weld simulations with performance in a single environment and even in a single licensing scheme. So we have our solutions, which we call Virtual Manufacturing Solution and Virtual Performance Solution, which are sharing same licensing and same interface. So that's about it. That's what I wanted to present to you today. I'm very open to any questions you might have today or even later on.
Okay, so we do have a question. Does this process work for MIG welded assemblies?
Yes, it does. So the same thinking that the same examples I showed for spot welding, they do work for MIG and MAG welding.
Okay, and so another question is simulation time an issue in this proposed approach?
Yeah, that's a good question. We know I've shown many results, and people are normally asking how long does it take to run all these cases. And for the welding simulation itself, welding simulation towards distortion predictions is something that is not, it doesn't take long. It's like a few minutes, and that's why we can do an optimization of weld sequencing, because each iteration takes a few minutes, so you can do hundreds of tries in a reasonable time. And something else for stamping and crash, We are very good in parallelization, so we can run on many cores, one job in many cores today, and we are promoting the usage of both PAM stamp and VPS, our software, in many cores, even as an entry configuration. So normally companies today, big hardware start to be very common. So you can run on 16, 32, 64 cores and get results in a very reasonable time.
All right, thank you. So if you have any more questions, don't hesitate to reach out to us. And thank you for joining the webinar. And thank you, Arthur, for the great presentation.
Thank you.
Have a nice day.
Thank you.